Hi everyone, here is what to expect following the Bitcoin crash we've seen during this weekend and what are the most important events on the macroeconomic and company earnings calendar for the week ahead. So a significant plunge in Bitcoin and altcoin prices marked the weekend. While there is no one exact reason that explains this move, fear of seeing the US regulators step in, especially after Turkey announced it forbid payments in cryptocurrencies altogether and even sending money on crypto trading platforms on Friday, a brutal drop in Bitcoin's hash rate, which is actually the measuring unit of the processing power of the Bitcoin network, fell significantly due to a government-induced power shortage in the Chinese mining plants, combined to some profit-taking, obviously, at the record high levels following last week's Coinbase IPO that we all followed, should explain a part of the 15% plunge in Bitcoin we've seen over the weekend. Of course, the plunge in Bitcoin's price generated panic across all cryptocurrencies, or almost all. Dogecoin, for example, did quite well. Remember, Dogecoin came out as a joke, but it's now well supported by Elon Musk. But, you know, that's about it for the moment. I wouldn't be too optimistic or too excited by Dogecoin's positive performance in the longer run. Now, the price action in cryptocurrencies looks actually dramatic, but it's not that bad for this market. Remember, at the beginning of 2018, we've seen the price of a coin plunge from near $20,000 to below $5,000. So the same risk exists right now as well. So this weekend's plunge showed us once again that Bitcoin's volatility is not benign, and crypto investments are highly profitable, but they also carry a very high risk as well. So this market is subject to high volatility, as I say, and may not be for everyone. But looking at the price action right now, Bitcoin did quite a good job attracting dip buyers approaching the $50,000 level. I believe we have been this close to a more significant drama in this market, but the danger looks like it's past for now. So what will probably happen in the coming days is consolidation within the $55,000-$62,000 range for now. So consolidation should be on the agenda for other crypto assets as well. So is it time to buy Bitcoin? Yes, if you will, but only if you have solid nerves and a good tolerance to risk, of course. Now, let's talk about what else we will be watching and talking about this week. We have earnings from important names throughout the week. Among them, I see Coca-Cola, IBM, and United Airlines will release first quarter earnings today. Netflix, Procter & Gamble, Philip Morris International, and Johnson & Johnson is on Tuesday. Nestle, Credit Suisse, American Airlines, Intel, and Snap, and Biogen on Thursday, and American Express and Honeywell on Friday. Elsewhere, shares of Trip.com began trading in Hong Kong today and gained near 5%. Well, you may think that shares, the share prices of companies active in tourism and travel may have lagged during the pandemic, but that's a misperception for some of these shares, which actually saw their prices rising significantly and didn't let the tech competition slip by. TripAdvisors, for example, outperformed Nasdaq during the 2020 rally following the March plunge. So that was a positive. Keep in mind. Anyway, back to our earnings discussion. The most watched results will be the big tech results, of course. We may continue seeing a strong demand for Netflix services in the first quarter as the lockdown measures have kept many of us nailed at home during the first quarter of the year. So the expectations are quite strong according to a consensus of analyst estimates. Netflix earnings may have increased to $1.98 from $1.19 reported a quarter earlier. The only thing is that Netflix, as other tech stocks, are now under the pressure of the so-called reflation trade, reflation theme, and could see a limited appetite from now on due to the reopening of economies and people hitting the streets after having spent more than a year stuck in front of their television. So Netflix will certainly see its business shaken at some point for the quarters ahead. We have already started seeing some slowdown in the upside trend in Netflix share prices, but we don't expect to see a significant plunge in Netflix shares either. So Snap, on the other hand, could announce another round of negative earnings this quarter. So as you know, Snap remains somewhat in the shadow of other big tech names, but its investors have little to envy competition in terms of price surge in the market. So negative earnings or not, a better than expected result still carries the potential to drive the price of Snap shares higher this week. But I believe that the cyclical names such as banks and especially energy stocks should do better for the week and the weeks ahead because of this reflation theme, reflation trading. Especially on the energy front, we have seen some good news. The International Energy Agency announced that the global oil supply finally eased significantly recently. That was partly due to an improved global demand and mostly due to the low production regime from the OPEC plus countries over the quarters before. So in February, barely a fifth of the supply glut remained according to the latest news, and that could be gone in no time with the reopening of economies and the recovery in economic activity globally. So the lower supply glut combined to the prospects of higher global demand, especially after we've seen that 18% jump in the Chinese GDP figure last week, hints that the demand supply dynamics could actually be turning in favor of oil prices. We still see some resistance near the $65 per barrel level in the US crude and near $70-$72 in Brent crude. So it will be interesting to watch if these resistance levels could be taken out. But JP Morgan sees the Brent oil breaking decisively the $70 mark by May, yet they still keep their year-end target unchanged near the $74 per barrel, and 2022 forecast lower by some $10 to $69 per barrel. So don't roll up your sleeves just yet for the $100 target, but it looks like we still could see some positive trend in the coming days in these oil prices, and that should also boost the prices of energy companies. So keep an eye on BP, on Shell, and on Exxon shares as interesting reflation trade options. Now, it will be also interesting to watch the air travel companies this week. They are doing badly due to a great decline in the air traffic during the pandemic period, obviously. And again, obviously, prospects of rising energy prices right now should continue weighing a little bit more on their revenues in the short run, at least, as their energy costs may increase faster than their revenues after the reopening of economies, as it is believed that the air travels will improve slowly only. So that could be another period of hardship for airline companies. So on the macroeconomic front, the UK inflation data on Wednesday is important, as we may see some acceleration in both the headline and the core inflation figures in March. And more importantly, these figures will serve as a basis on what we may see later on, as we will probably be seeing a peak in April and May figures as people start hitting the streets as a result of the end of these long lockdown measures in Britain. So Friday's flash PMI data could also throw some light on the economic activity in April in the UK, and we could see positive surprises on that front as well, especially on the services front, which is actually all that matters for the UK, where services stand for nearly 80% of the total economic activity. So depending on the strength of the economic data this week, we will see the Bank of England hawks joining the party and strengthen the past week's positive trend in pound sterling, aiming a return about the 140 level against the US dollar and maybe back to the 0.85 mark against the euro. So speaking of the euro, the European Central Bank will announce its latest monetary policy decision on Thursday, and it is expected to maintain its ultra supportive monetary policy unchanged to continue giving some more support to the pandemic ravaged European economies, as the inflation levels in Europe remain under control for now. Even though for all countries out there, the US, Europe or other countries, doesn't matter, the higher inflation risks are tilted to the upside with these rising energy costs combined combined to these ultra supportive monetary policies, of course. Anyway, we were discussing last week that the ECB's balance sheet continues growing significantly with the pandemic purchases, pandemic bond purchases, and that is not ready to stop anytime soon. So the loose ECB should continue keeping the euro bears alert and may not give way to a further recovery above the 120 mark against the US dollar. So to me, levels near 120 seem quite interesting for those looking to short the euro dollar for a medium term decline toward the 118-117 area. Elsewhere, the Bank of Canada is expected to maintain its rates unchanged on Wednesday, and the flash PMI figures on Friday could show some further strength in the European activity as well, thanks to an improved activity during the Easter holiday that we've seen after Germany decided not to strengthen its lockdown measures. Now, in summary, stronger oil, a firmer pound, weaker euro, hesitancy regarding the forward guidance on the tech front, and of course the consolidation in the cryptocurrency prices are what you should be keeping an eye on for the week ahead. So this is all for today. I'm Ipek Ozkardeskaya, and thank you for joining me. I hope this episode of Market Talk has been helpful and insightful to you. Please do not hesitate to follow us on Twitter and on LinkedIn for regular market updates, and subscribe to our YouTube channel for daily market comments. I meet you again tomorrow, and until then, good day trading.